Today we've been joined by a very special individual. She is the first ever Sri Lankan women's cricketer to score 1,000 runs and take 100 wickets in one-day internationals. She also led Sri Lanka to their first ever victory against England and India at the 2013 Cricket World Cup. And she was also once ranked in 2014 as the best all-rounder in T20 internationals. And also she represented the World 11 in 2014 at the home of cricket, the Lord's Cricket Ground. She is none other than Sashikala Sirivardhana. Thank you very much, Sashikala, for accepting my invitation to feature on the show.
Thank you very much for inviting me also.
When you talk about your 17 years of illustrious cricketing career, one of the two main achievements I would say is wins against England and India at the 2013 Cricket World Cup. The first win came against England, I guess it was on the 1st of February 2013. It was a chase, 238 runs England scored, and in the last ball the wicketkeeper hit a six to take us over the line. Can you recall memories of that particular match?
Yeah, it was a very special tournament for us. I think for all women cricketers in Sri Lanka, the lives changed for us. It was our dream to, you know, we wanted to change the history in this tournament. That is what we were planning before we go there. And we knew that we had to, we hadn't won any matches against New Zealand, Australia, India, England when we were going that World Cup. So we wanted to change that history. So against England, it was our main achievement was that we could able to restrict them to that score, especially on that wicket. So girls had that faith, and the management and coach and all officials also had that faith that we can chase this. So we had a good start, especially Atapattu, Yashoda, they gave a lot of good starts on that tournament. And also Ishani, she's the one who changed everyone's lives at that match. And especially Chamani Seniviratna, Sripali, they all did their best. And most importantly, that six was hit by Dilani Manohar in the last bowl. So I think overall it's a team effort, which we were lacking all the time, like 6 to 7 performances from the playing 11. So we came to know that it's a big thing that if we can keep performing like this, we can beat any team in the world.
What was the biggest takeaway on that particular match, Sashikala? After England, that particular win at the 2013 Cricket World Cup, we did not win any matches against England.
Except the practice match in the T20 World Cup, last T20 World Cup, we could beat them. But I think that team that we had in that 2013 World Cup, we couldn't have that kind of team again in our country. Especially a lot of seniors were retiring. So that combination we couldn't make after that tournament. That is what I believe regarding our performances in the last few years.
After that particular match, within about 5-6 days, we beat India for the first time in our history as well. We scored 282 runs for the loss of 5 wickets, and we beat India by a huge margin, 138 runs or something like that. And you were a major contributor in that particular match as well.
Actually, after winning against England, we didn't sleep. So that much we were happy. Every player was really happy what we achieved. And we wanted to beat New Zealand and Australia, but we couldn't. Especially we had a bad defeat against West Indies after that England match. It really hits us. So then we get together and we plan how to be in the Super Six. So we have to beat either Australia, New Zealand or India. At that time, if we beat India, they had to go out from the Super Six stage. As hosting nation, I think it's a big blow for them, and we knew that they had a pressure of that also. So we tried to use that also. So after winning against India, we had several chances to beat them after that tournament also, and they were like really taking us serious after that. So we could able to win a T20 series in India against India in 2014 also. So when we are going to play a match, we could able to give some threat to other teams after that tournament.
Now, talking about the beginnings, in 1997, Sri Lanka started women's cricket, and in 2006 only, Sri Lanka women's cricket was taken under Sri Lanka cricket boards, under the wings of Sri Lanka cricket board. There was one special person who started cricket and kind of enabled women's sport to be a sport to be considered in Sri Lanka. Can we talk a little bit about Gwen Herath?
Yeah, that's Mrs. Gwen Herath, the president of Sri Lanka Women's Cricket Association at that time, which was registered under IWCC at that time. And she was the one who, you know, gave everything, a lot of dedication and hard work. We had very few sponsors at that time, especially Singer and MS Holdings. They are the ones who helped women's cricket at that time to, you know, to Mrs. Gwen Herath and the other few officials in Sri Lanka. And as a first captain, Vanessa De Silva, when she was captaining, we had that World Cup in 1997 in India. So, with Vanessa and all the other seniors, they really helped Mrs. Gwen Herath to do their best at that time, because that seniors only played for their passion and all, because at that time this was not professional, and so they couldn't gain anything, like financially there was nothing. So at that time Mrs. Gwen Herath did a tremendous job to keep this going until the Sri Lanka cricket got engaged in 2006.
Now, you made your debut at the age of 18, and you were made the captain after 3 years into the national side. How was it taking the leadership of a country at such a young age?
Yeah, when I was making my debut, it was against West Indies, in West Indies. I had a very special tournament, like I did really well, more than expected. So it really boosted my courage and my braveness, I think. With that, I had to play in a team where a lot of seniors were there. So I, myself, Sandamali Dolavath and Randhika, they were the youngsters when I was touring my first few tours. Suddenly in 2005, a lot of seniors retired at that time. So we had a very young upcoming team, like Sripal Veerakodi, Prabha Udavath. So a lot of new players were coming into the team. So at that time, Mrs. Gwen Herath asked me to do the captaincy, and also that time the coach was Bernard Pereira, the late Bernard Pereira. And my first coach was Nihal Kodithuakku. He was the one who picked me. Like, there were a lot of seniors and a lot of off spinners also, but I think he saw something inside me, and he had a lot of struggle to get me into the team also. So I must thankful to Nihal Kodithuakku, Mr. Nihal Kodithuakku, that he believed on me. So after becoming the Mr. Bernard Pereira, who was the next coach of the team, and he and Mrs. Gwen Herath offered me the captaincy. So at that time, I had no one to take any advices, only my father. So I went to my father and I told that they are offering me the captaincy at this age. I had no experience on captaining, because I captained my first club, Paling Sports Club, for a few years. So what should I do? I asked my tata. So he told that I think you should take it, you should give a try. Let's see. So that's a challenge I had, and I think all the girls really helped me, who are the seniors who left, also advised me after retiring from the team. Also, they kept in touch with me, still they do. So I think I must thankful to my seniors for that, to, you know, making me comfortable at that level.
Let's go back in time. Now, you were made as a captain of Sri Lanka at the age of 21, and you made your debut at the age of 18. When did you actually start the sport of cricket?
In 1998. I started playing hardball cricket in 1998 in Paling Sports Club under Mr. Palathu Gunasekara. He was my first coach. It happened like, you know, I used to play cricket with my brother and my friends, like gully cricket and all. So one of my father's friend saw me playing, and he proposed my father to take me to like academy or club. So at that time there were very less academies and clubs for girls. So Mr. Palitha was trying to form a new club for girls. So I had that opportunity to go with my father, and that uncle's son also in that academy. So every Sunday we used to go there, and we just started playing just for passion, not dreaming anything big. So while studying and all, I just went there only every Sunday till like 6 or 7 years I went there.
You got married in 2013, and usually in subcontinent after marriage you don't see women pursuing their career, seldom people do it. But how come you continued cricket after 2013?
In our countries, like when we were in 23, 22, mothers are starting to, you know, telling that you have to think about your personal life, marriage and all. So as my mother also, she used to talk about that a lot. But I told her that I have some plans, I have some targets, just give me some time and we'll think about that. So like that I could able to pass some time. And then I met Namal Seniviratna, my husband. At that time he was coaching MC Academy, and I used to play for MS Holdings like mercantile matches. From that I met him. After that we were like friends. So I had plans, and I wanted to continue till I do something for cricket without marriage, because I had that kind of thought that after marriage it's not easy to play or do a sports. So that was my idea about marriage. So when we talk about that, when we plan to get married, I told Namal that I will quit after marriage. So he asked why, that's a question he asked. So I said I think I have to be fully committed for the family and all, so that's why I decided. So he asked me why you are doing this, if you are performing well. It was just after that World Cup.
2013 World Cup.
Yeah. So he was saying that, yeah, you have achieved something, but you have to achieve more, and you are performing well. So if you are physically fit, if you are performing, marriage should not be a problem for your future plans about cricket. So he told me that he will support in every way, you just continue. So with that I had that chance, and especially his parents also really helpful, his family also. So I must thankful to them also supporting me, my mother, my sister also. My sister also playing a huge role, because for any particular things regarding related to my family's things, my sister used to represent me when I'm missing. So I think with their all support I could able to continue after marriage also.
At this point of time, women's cricket has taken a huge leap forward just because of you guys, Shashikala Siriwardhan and the likes of Chamari Atapattu. Now people must be watching, they want their children to play cricket in the future by the way that they are seeing how world cricket is being played by women. What type of challenges did you face at the initial stage when you started a sport which has been dominated by men?
Yeah, initially it was not that easy. Without the help of families, especially parents, it's not easy to start. So I think comparing to those days, we did not have any salaries or contracts, especially clothing, equipment problems, traveling problems. We had a lot of problems due to lack of sponsorships and money involved in women's cricket, especially in Sri Lanka. So at that time we had that passion to just play cricket and to represent the country someday. That was the only plan. I can remember once when we were doing physical fitness at Coles ground, our senior players' parents used to send us food because the association couldn't afford it. So sometimes we ate like polsambar, bread. So those are the things that we had to face, but we were really happy. So that's why we could continue cricket with those difficulties. And especially MS did a great job to keep cricketers involved, because they offered jobs. I also worked there, MS Holdings. A lot of our women cricketers initially worked there, and singer. After that in 2011, three forces, because of them I think I could able to continue this much of cricket, this much of years to play cricket, because the strength we had from the forces, especially in financial and other all facilities that they have given I work in Sri Lanka Navy. It's been like 9.5 years now. So I think with their support also, we could able to play this long. And Sri Lanka cricket contracts, it also really helped. But I think earlier when we used to go to a tour, we had to borrow our clothes also from the drop player. We had to take the clothes from them. So from that kind of situation, now it's totally different. There are a lot of job opportunities, financial strengths, and especially, you know, you can have a lot of equipments, clothing, whatever you want, and the internationally high recognized coaching staff, the facilities Sri Lanka cricket is giving, it's like same to men's cricket, except the financial thing, other things are very similar to the men's team. So I think now it's really easy pathway for girls to come into the national team and to perform.
Great. Now in 2015, you had to do an operation in your finger, I guess, in 2015, right? Mm-hmm. And thereafter hamstring injury.
Yeah.
And thereafter you meet with an accident, a motorbike accident. And then your wound get infected and the doctors couldn't find the name of the bacteria for 50 days and you have to go to India to find that. What motivated you to come back?
Yeah, the first major injury was in 2015, that finger injury in Dubai against Pakistan. But within 2-3 months, I could recover and play. But that hamstring injury really bothered me because it was like it was similar to an accident. Doctor was saying that it really happens to wrestlers and all. So it was like accident, like my legs got apart and it was detached from the starting point of the hamstring. So it was little bit different than other cricketing injuries. But Dr. Pardiwala, who's from India, he did my operation and he made sure that he gave me confidence that definitely this will be okay within 6 to 7 months. Don't worry about that. Just keep doing what your physio says. At that time, my physio was Miss Neha from India, and also Arvind from Sri Lanka cricket. He also helped. After that, I met with an accident. From that, Sri Lanka cricket helped me a lot. Even though it was my personal thing that I was going for some my personal work, I had that accident. But Sri Lanka cricket really helped me on that. Especially Tasneem Yusuf, the physio at that time, he made sure that I had to play because I wanted to play again. I didn't want to give up, but I had very less hopes when I was going from Sri Lanka to India for an operation for that. Few doctors told me that maybe I can't play again and all. But my husband and my family backed me a lot, and my physio Tasneem Yusuf, they told me just keep faith. We'll see what Dr. Pardiwala says. And so I left to India, and he also had 50-50 chances. But after the operation, he told me that definitely you can play. So I must thankful to the selection committee at that time, especially Rasanjali Dialbis and Hemanta Devapriya and Inoka Ranavira, the captain. With the injury, they gave me the chance of playing 2017 World Cup purely because of my cricket experience. Because in that fitness, at that time, fitness level was like 75% for me to fit in the team. But the three of them really gave me that chance to do, considering my experience. So if from that, I had that strength to play with the injury also.
Following the conclusion of the Bangladesh match, your final international match, you took 4 wickets, a man of the match performance. There were some pictures circulated in social media where the Indian team had signed a T-shirt. And the T-shirt read, "Thank you for your contribution towards women's cricket. You're a legend and a true sportswoman. Best wishes and good luck on your future endeavors, Team India." What is that special bond that you're sharing with the Indian team?
Actually, from the beginning, we have played a lot of cricket with India because it was very hard to play cricket against Australia, New Zealand and England at that time because they were not offering tournaments or tours for us. But India, Pakistan, West Indies, South Africa, we had that kind of relationship all the time, that we meet each other a lot of time to play tournaments. So I think I have special bonds with like Sana Mir, Mithali Raj. They are really close to me. From India, the new players like Mandana, Rodrigues, Harman, we used to see each other in the matches like opponents. But I think they had loved the way I behave in the middle. Sometimes after they offering and giving me that jersey, they told me that they love the person inside me, like off the field and on the field both. So I was really surprised that they had, you know, they were about to go to the semi-finals at that time, but they had time to give me that jersey and go, because they were leaving Melbourne at that time to another state for the semi-finals. So I was really surprised in that morning, and I thanked them. Still, we have that bond, especially after going to T20 Challenge in Dubai. The bond is really strong after that also. So I must thankful to them. It really made my career very bright with that compliment.
I guess, you know, we should be a Sri Lankan also, to be Sri Lankans, we should be proud of as well, Sasika Love, for the manner in which that you conducted yourself in the cricketing world. Talking about 2014, you were selected to play for the World 11 at the Home of Cricket. And you had players alongside you like Charlotte Edwards, Elise Perry, Susie Bates, Meg Lanning. And would have been such an amazing experience. Talk to me about, you know, what did you guys speak?
Yeah, it was such an amazing experience to share the dressing room with them. We had only 5 days together, but I think it was the best time, excepting the 2013 World Cup, it was the best time in my cricketing career that I could able to, you know, be with them, share our knowledge, and I could able to grab lots of things from their experience and the high-class cricket that they play. Like I had a dream of playing in Lords, or go to the Lords ground and watch a match also. So I have dreamt about that a lot of times. So suddenly, after the T20 World Cup in 2014, I got this email that I have been selected for the World 11, and we are going to Lords and playing a match for their anniversary, the ground's anniversary. So I think this is a very special moment for me, and I feel that it's a big achievement for me also. So I will cherish that forever.
And that match was played between the World 11 and the MCC 11. And I guess World 11 was led by Susie Bates, and MCC was led by Charlotte Edwards, the England women's cricket player. What did you guys discuss prior to going into the match? You guys won that match, actually.
Yeah, we won. We had, you know, a little bit worried, like they got two West Indian players with ducks. So, but Mithali saved us. Mithali really played well for us. So, and also bowling when the bowling was on, Sana Mir also bowled really well, and I could able to get Heather Knight because they had a very good partnership. They were 94 no loss, so I could able to get Heather Knight's wickets also. So before we going to that match, we did not have a lot of plans. Players were really enjoying the practice also, and we had a very little discussion. That they were saying that, you know, you are the best, that is why you are here. So I don't have to advise you guys what to do. You just play your normal game, play freely and enjoy the game. That's the only thing that the captain was saying. So sometimes I felt that we talk lot of things. We pressurizing ourselves before a match. But for the first time, I saw that how much they are relaxed before a match. So I got that enjoy thing very much from that speech, and I was trying to apply that to myself after coming back to Sri Lanka and playing for Sri Lanka.
That's at a different level. You're playing with the best 11, 22 players in the world. But when it comes to Sri Lanka, you have a mix of, you know, very good players and players who are upcoming. What type of a message do you give the players prior to going into the field, the team meeting? You know, what do you talk about?
Yeah, like analyzing thing came to this field. We do a lot of analyzing before the match day. Apart from that, before a match, the team wants to hear something positive. So sometimes I speak to the team, sometimes I give that opportunity to who's a positive player on that particular day. Maybe she had score a big score previous match. So I give that opportunity to some players to get experience also. But when I was speaking to them, I just want to make sure that every player should play to their potential and just try to do more than 100%. If and also in the practices also, I used to say that do more than 100%, because in a match, automatically we are doing more than 100%. If you practice at 100% level, so match won't be in our side. So I was always trying to make them positive and to play the natural game, leave the outside pressures, because for a player there are a lot of outside pressures. It becomes inside pressure for us if we think about that a lot. So I used to speak to girls certain things of like that too before a match.
What about Chamari Athapattu? She, you yeah. played under her also. Yeah. What does she say?
Yeah, she's a unique one. She's a very special one in the team. She shows that she doesn't get any pressure, I think. I haven't seen that she's pressurized from anything. So that kind of a player she is. And all the youngsters have to learn a lot of from her, because she boosts our energy also. And I think she's becoming the icon of women's cricket in Sri Lanka, because like in men's cricket, Sanat Jayasurya, the all girls cricket or women's cricket in the world, they are really afraid of Athapattu. And you know, all the bowlers, they are thinking thousands of things before bowling a ball to Athapattu. I have seen it. So I think she's a very good like sister for me. We have very good bond even after retirement also. I think I must congratulate her for her achievements and wish her all the best to do more things to Sri Lanka women's cricket.
What are the unique features of Chamari Athapattu? How does she get herself prepared prior to a match?
Actually, sometimes she thinks a lot about the wicket. Sometimes she thinks lots of things about the wicket in the initial stages. If the wicket is not good, she's not going to practice there. So some other girls are not like that. They want to practice somehow, but she thinks that if the practice session doesn't give her the confidence, she doesn't want to practice. She thinks that she is confident than that to be in the match. So there are very lots of things that I also learning from her before a match. The positive mind of her, the fearless cricket, and she's always updating. She's trying to, you know, she doesn't stick to one particular stance or one particular things, one particular basics. She always trying to update herself, watching other countries' players, watching lots of bowlers who she has to face, and who are the best batters who have faced them, those bowlers, how they manage that bowlers. So there are a lot of things that we can learn from Chamari Athapattu. She's a huge analyzer of other teams also, and very good memory and sharp mind. So I think she's very different from the other players.
We spoke about your captaincy stints, you and Chamari Athapattu. What do you do after a defeat?
Myself, I get very upset. But I'm trying to not to show to my players or officials. But when I go back to my room, I really suffer a defeat. So I blame myself. That I'm not blaming anyone, because I know I could able to make the team win. So I am trying to analyze myself. Why did I do that? Why did I do this and all? So I am blaming myself a lot. But I know that as a captain, tomorrow morning I have to face my team with positive vibes. So when I'm getting to the sleep, I just want to remove the bad memories of that match, and I will determine that not to repeat the mistakes I did, and make sure the others also do the same, and listening to music and all, and watching a movie, so I can be refreshed.
It's been 23 years since the commencement of Sri Lanka women's cricket, and the closest that we have come to a World Cup dream was in 2013, I guess, when we got to fifth place. Why weren't we able to get beyond that?
I think the big match pressure is there. If we know that if we win these two matches, we can get into the semis, we are not winning that. So we are trying to pressurize ourselves thinking of the big picture sometimes, because we had lost lots of chances to be in the first four or first two in last few years. I have witnessed it, I have played those matches, and also our fielding at that crucial times, it's not that up to that mark after 2014. So I must highlight on that also, and we have to play lots of matches to, you know, to cope with that pressure. You know, match should be like a normal thing for us, and players should enjoy what they are doing. This is a World Cup match, this is very important. If you think like that, definitely players are not, you know, delivering their best. I think we have to like build a good mental side in our team, and also the practices. More we play practice matches or even additional tours. Now we are playing lots of ICC conducted matches, like we have the ICC Championship. We have to play all the top 8 teams in 3 years' time. So I think other countries, they are playing a lot of bilateral series except those ICC matches. So I think we must play the matches against higher standard teams more than us. And also if we can play matches against boys, not under 15 or 17, maybe under 19 level, definitely we can make an impact to this current squad.
Talking about Harsha De Silva, who was a coach at the 2013 Cricket World Cup, he had played an enormous part in terms of, you know, your success in that particular tournament. And I've had an interview with Angelo Matthews as well back in the days, and then he had played a huge part in terms of Angelo's emergence as well as a cricketer. What was actually Harsha De Silva's role?
Yeah, when he was coming in 2012 to the team, we had a lot of problems in the teams, like, you know, the unity problems. It is very common, especially among women's teams. But I think first thing he was doing that, make sure that team is one unit. And as a captain, sometimes I had faults also inside me. He used to speak with us a lot. He tried to get what we think inside, because girls are not that expressive. Like, they are not, you know, they are emotional, but they are not throwing it out. So sometimes it's a barrier for the team. So he used to take everything inside of us, and he used to advise what to do and what to do not. So as a captain, I learned speaking with him lots of things, and I think he changed the way we played to play like a unit. And his specialty was, you know, he's managing the player a lot. Because sometimes we need our coach to be a father. Sometimes, you know, sometimes he has to be a teacher. So he had lots of qualities. Because when we see his family background also, he has 3 daughters and very, very nice wife. So I think he made us a family. So I think he managed us a lot. So he's a very good analyst. He taught us to how to analyze other teams, how to hit those weaknesses of other teams. So he had a lot of qualities, and I learned a lot of things from him. I think he's a major one who changed our lives regarding to 2013 World Cup from that also. And special thing is that after he leaving the country in 2014, he just keep talking to our players, myself, especially Atapattu. He was, you know, guiding us from there also. That much he loves this women's cricket. We always wanted a coach who's not doing the job and taking the salary and going back. We want someone who loves women's cricket. And I think he has that quality. He loved women's cricket. He wanted to make sure that women's cricket in Sri Lanka, women's cricket is in higher standard. So I think that's his specialty for me as a coach.
Obviously, the general public was wanting Sri Lanka cricket, women's cricket in particular, to emerge to the next level. We always had Sashikala Sirivardhana and Chamari Atapattu in our minds whenever, if we think about Sri Lanka women's cricket. Who are the other players that we can look forward to in the future?
Yeah, after you know, Sri Lanka cricket started a very good structure for school cricket back in like 6 years ago. From that, we are having the output now, because four schoolgirls toured the last T20 World Cup. So it's a big achievement for us, because we were lacking new players in the team, because with the new girls, I think the seniors have to perform more than what were they doing. So as a team, it helped us to perform well. So we didn't have that second team in our country. So after having a good structure in school cricket, especially after Mrs. Apsari came into the Sri Lanka cricket, they had big matches and all. So with that, we have now a very good second side. So from that also, I think Harshita Madhavi, Hasini Pereira, Kavisha Dilhari, Satya Sandeepani, Umesha Timashani and Tharika Sevandi, they have already shown a huge impact. They have already played in the Sri Lankan side while they are schooling. So I think they have a huge journey, and with the mix of that, get into, you know, mixing with experienced players like Chamari Atapattu, Deshika Prabodhini, Dilani Manodhara, Inoka Ranaveera. So with that, I think we'll have a very good team in the future.
We also hope that, you know, Sri Lanka women's cricket will get to the next level, and we should be able to follow women's cricket like the way that we follow the men's cricket, and the game could get spreaded across the country. You announced your retirement after the 2020 T20 World Cup. What's after cricket now? You've been playing domestic cricket though, but what's after that?
Actually, I retired in March, yes, and I'm continuing my work at Sri Lanka Navy as a player at the moment. Due to corona pandemic, the tournament was postponed, the domestic ones, but still having hopes that it will happen soon. And also we are getting ready for the Defence Services Tournament, which is happening in every 2 years, and which is really important for us as a Navy team. So I'm focusing on that also, and also I've been coaching little girls in Mercantile Cricket Association Academy from 2015. So I have given more focus on that also after my retirement, and also have applied for the level 2 coaching certificate program conducting by Sri Lanka Cricket, and waiting for that also. So those are the things happening at the moment.
What about getting into administration?
I really love doing coaching. If I have any chance to serve from that with my experience, definitely I will prefer that for the Sri Lanka women's cricket structure.
Thank you very much, Sashikala, for accepting my invitation to feature on the show. It was indeed a pleasure to have you on the show, and I'm sure our viewers would have gained a lot about women's cricket in Sri Lanka in particular, and of course what we can look forward in terms of women's cricket in Sri Lanka. Once again, thank you very much, and we wish you good luck and all the best for your future endeavors.
Thank you so much for inviting me also.